Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for joining us at the SBI Hangar for Fractured Times, Can Humor Save Us? For this session, we have with us V.G. Narendra, the brain behind the Indian Institute of Cartoonists, the first national-level organization of cartoonists in India. He was influenced by the cartoons of the great Shankar during his school days, and he soon started drawing pocket and political cartoons for newspapers. With a science degree from the Karnataka University, he has contributed to the Illustrated Weekly of India and the Dharm Yug, among other magazines. His pocket cartoon, Reporter Sanju, began appearing in over 15 dailies in several languages. And his work caught the eye of Shankar, and he was then invited to join Shankar's weekly. Mr. Narendra was instrumental in forming the Karnataka Cartoonists Association way back in 1977 and has organized a conference of cartoonists in which many leading cartoonists such as R.K. Lakshman, Abu Abraham and Maria Miranda were a part of. Joining him, we have the stand-up comedian Varun Grover, a lyricist, a short fiction and a screenplay writer based out of Mumbai. Varun's work in movies like Gangs of Wasseypur and Masaan have been widely appreciated. He has won a National Film Award for Best Lyrics for Dum Lagake Haisha. He is the lead writer for the massively popular web series Sacred Games, which is Netflix's first fiction series in India. Varun has also forayed into writing for graphic novels and short stories for children. Joining the gentlemen, we have Sonu Venugopal, more popularly known for hilariously funny online character called Baju Mani Kaku. She is an RJ, a mentor, a social media influencer, an improv artist, and a stand-up comic, and a quintessential girl next door South Indian. She currently hosts the evening drive show on Radio City 91.1 called City Matu, and has made her way into the hearts of not only Bangaloreans, but also the people of Karnataka. She is a part of two very popular comedy ensembles, Gandhi Class and Improvise, where she performs as a stand-up comedian and as an improv artist. And they are in conversation with Papa CJ, an award-winning, world-renowned international stand-up comedian. Harvard Business Review called him one of the most influential comedians around the world. With an MBA degree from the University of Oxford, he is an experienced motivational speaker as well. He has been invited to speak at the Harvard University and at the University of Oxford. As a corporate coach, he has trained over 50 blue chip companies globally. Under his initiative called the Papa CJ Happiness Project, he performs in support of charitable causes across the world. Ladies and gentlemen, it's my honor to welcome V.G. Narendra, Varun Grover, Sonu Venugopal, and Papa CJ for Fractured Times, Can Humor Save Us?
Hi guys, it is my task to host this this panel today, and let me just start by saying on behalf of all of the panelists, and I'm pretty sure I speak for all of us, it is extremely embarrassing for all of us to sit while our introductions are being read out and we're like, can you please just stop it and just get us onto stage? So we would like to apologize for that. Also, we started slightly late. I'm afraid Varun is responsible for that because he was coming in and they asked him for his pass and he said, sorry, bhaiya, hum kagaz nahi dikhayenge.
Yeah, they tried their best to not let me reach. I was dropped at Bangalore Palace, which is, you know, and I thought, okay, it's such a beautiful film set for a lit fest. And then I realized, one, it is not a film set, it's an actual palace, and there's no lit fest happening there. And there was nobody, I mean, the cab dropped us there, and then we had to wait 20 minutes to get here. So sorry for the delay, I'm really sorry, because yeah, I should have known the Bangalore landmarks.
Bangalore is deceptive like that, because when we fly to Bangalore, we think we're landing in an airport that is actually somewhere close to Bangalore, which clearly is not the case. So guys, I'll tell you how we're going to structure this session, just as a heads up. We were going to do intros, but that's already done. I'm going to ask each of the panelists to give us a short opening statement on what their thoughts are about this session, whether humor can save us in fractured times. Then one by one, we'll do individual questions for each of the panelists based on their experience, a broad range of questions for them. And then we will open up to the audience for question and answers. And if the panelists have any questions for any of the other panelists or for the audience, we're going to let them ask those questions as well. Are you guys good with that? It's post-lunch, so we need a bit more of a cheer. Are you guys good with that? Wonderful. So let's start with the senior most gentleman with us, Narendraji.
Good evening. The subject is, can humor save us? So, I would like to go one step further.
So just keep the microphone closer to you this way.
I would like to, because of that, the art of cartooning has grown like a big banyan tree with having pendant roots deep rooted in all the languages, in all the states. And lots of cartoonists are coming up and they are drawing cartoons every day in the morning. And they are touching the hearts of the readers. The art of cartooning is alive and kicking. That is what I wanted to say.
Can humor save us? I don't know, honestly. I mean, humor can save us, say, from authoritarian regimes, but it can't save us from climate change, right? So, or climate crisis, actually, not change. That was like the term used 10 years ago, but yeah. There are two ways of saving us. One is internally, can it save the artist? Yes. Can it save the world? I don't know. Can it save me, my humor? I think so. Because for me, humor is a way to deal with my own complexities, my own fears, my own anger, most of the times actually. And I feel that's why I create whatever comedy, because for me, I can't live with that anger. And I don't really want to be that guy who writes these angry YouTube comments to vent or any other form of violent confrontation. So for me, it is a way of simplifying myself or understanding myself where this anger is coming from and how to kind of diffuse the anger. And then, yeah, of course, then there's the external factor where humor in today's times has become probably the only art form which is getting the point across to people who don't agree with you, you know. Op-eds or even facts. People are not looking at facts now. If the facts don't agree with what your opinion is, people have stopped looking at facts. But humor comes with a story. It comes with a joke, and the beauty of a joke is, even if you don't agree with it, the biological reaction, you will laugh at it because it springs a surprise, it throws, you know, something which is unexpected, and you end up laughing. And the moment you laugh, you let down your guards, and then that virus or germ of opinion, which was my opinion, you didn't agree with, has kind of entered your brain or entered your body, entered your system. And then maybe in that moment you can say, okay, I don't agree with the opinion, but you're laughing, and then that germ is with you, and someday when you are about to pick up a weapon, maybe that germ will tell you, no, there's a joke here, man, just chill, it's just a joke, it's just words. So yeah, that's my opinion.
Probably not the right time to talk about viruses entering other people, but Sonu.
I kind of agree with whatever Varun said. I don't know about the broader perspective, but then for me, it's a vent. And I feel it's the most non-violent way to express yourself, which can be entertaining to other people as well. So I as he said, there is subtext to a joke as well. So for an audience that is listening to me, there are two takeaways. So you can laugh at the joke, and then when you go back home and think about it, oh, maybe there was a subtext, but you need not take the subtext. I mean, you can just laugh, have a good time, and maybe if you really want to think about it, there is a subtext also. So I feel like it's very personal for me right now. I don't know if I have the capacity to change the world and how people think, but it has definitely changed me because of all the complexities I had, and I thought that that's the best way for me to express myself. Maybe make fool of myself or fun at whatever I've been through and things like that. So if individually, if we look at that, I think it can save each one of us. And then if we work towards that, maybe we can work at a bigger cause as well. Yeah.
In fact, I agree completely with how Varun breaks it down, because we have similar experiences with regard to stand-up. From an external point of view, there's a saying by Mary Hirsch, which is that humor is like a rubber sword. You can make a point without drawing any blood. Of course, in today's day and age, often blood is still drawn, even if there is humor. But one of the other oldest sayings in comedy is that comedy is tragedy plus time. It's quite an interesting title, Fractured Times Can Humor Save Us. Because exactly 6 months ago, I had a massive road accident in Ladakh. I almost died. I've got a metal rod in my, a metal plate in my wrist, and a metal rod from my knee to my ankle. All throughout the time, while I was going through the accident, like literally from the time I fell down till the operation table onwards, I've written a whole new show about it called Unbroken. Even at that point, I'm suffering through the pain, and I'm thinking in 6 months' time, this is going to be hilarious on stage. So from an internal point of view as comedians, you know, often they ask that question that is the comedian the sad person? You know, are there tears behind it? I think what happens is as comedians, we get comfortable talking about our vulnerability on stage. And we are able to find a funny angle to it, to our pain. And when we express it, exactly like Varun said, there may be a point where somebody's trying to pick up a gun, but he's able to think back on a joke that Varun said and said, you know what, I mean, we can laugh about it. Why do you have to pick up a gun? So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to ask individual questions to each of the panelists based on their experience. We'll start with Narendraji. Narendraji, now, Shankar's Weekly was closed down during the emergency.
Yeah.
Can you tell us about your experience at that time? And how does that time compare with the day and age that we're living in today, in your experience?
Yeah, it is very sad that one and only Cartoon Weekly was closed in the days of emergency. Actually, Shankar, whom we call pioneer of Indian cartooning, who started that Shankar's Weekly in 1948. Before that, he was working with Hindustan Times, even before Britishers were ruling the country. And Britishers had a really great sense of humor. Once Lilith Go, the last vice-chancellor, viceroy, sent a word to Shankar and asked for the original of a cartoon. That's how, after we got independence, Nehru became the prime minister, and he liked the cartoons, and he patted Shankar to do free cartoons. He told Shankar that, "Don't spare me, Shankar." That was the great line still ringing in all our minds of, at all our stages in cartooning. He did lots of cartooning. He did all the lampooning of the Nehru era and Indira era. But for, alas, the person who supported the art of cartooning, Mr. Jawaharlal Nehru, his daughter became a tyranny, and the famous weekly was come to an end. I was working with a Free Press Journal in 1970s. So Shankar sent me a word appreciating my cartoons to join Shankar's Weekly in the 1970s. I joined him, but for I worked with him for only 2-3 years, but for the emergency, he closed it down. That is, I came down to Bangalore. That is my place. I worked here since 1976. Since then, I have been working as a political cartoonist in one paper or the other paper. And in 1977, we have a great event of Karnataka Cartoonist Association. And also in 1979, I was the president of Karnataka Cartoonists Association. When I was in Bombay, actually I met the legendary cartoonists R.K. Lakshman, Mario Miranda. Mario Miranda was also working with the Times of India. They were very appreciative of my work. And actually, when I became a president of Karnataka Cartoonists Association, I organized a big seminar of cartoonists of all over India. On the same stage, R.K. Lakshman, Mario Miranda, and Abu Abraham, all the great cartoonists, they came on the one stage that became the record in the history of the cartooning. All these legendary cartoonists never came on one stage. That gave me an idea of having a national level cartoon organization. That took me to 20 years to establish the Indian Institute of Cartoonists in 2001 with the chief patronship of Mario Miranda. Mario Miranda guided me all the time. See, that is how, that was the question Mr. Papa had asked.
So your pocket cartoon reporter Sanju appeared in over 15 dailies in several languages. Can you tell us a little bit about his persona, his point of view, what your thinking was behind?
Yeah. See, that was the earlier days when I went to Bombay after having earned a graduation from Karnataka University. So before that, while I was in college, my pocket cartoons and political cartoons had appeared on the front page of the newspapers. I had an album created and went to Bombay to explore and to develop my art of cartooning. I met the Times of India art director Ramesh Sanjgiri. He gave me a good support. He started publishing my cartoons in Illustrated Weekly and Dharmayug and many more things. At the same time, you must be knowing Mr. Anant Pai, who is no more now, and he started first of its kind in India, a first Indian feature syndicate. You know very well that this is an amazing world of comics, cartoon comics. Lots of cartoons were imported and printed on the newspapers, a full page. There were no Indian characters and there were no Indian feature syndicate that Anant Pai started with a collection of so many artists, so many cartoonists and writers. And I joined him to create one pocket cartoon that became Reporter Sanju. The name was actually the Sanju is a character in Mahabharata. Sanjaya reported to Dhritarashtra his thing and what went in Kurukshetra, so that he became a character for me, Reporter Sanju. That Rangrekha features, we went all over the India and requested all the newspapers. And when I created one Reporter Sanju that appeared in 15 language newspapers, including Kannada, Marathi, Telugu, Tamil, Konkani, and English, mostly medium-sized newspapers. That gave me very encouragement. And along with that, I started working with Free Press Journal as a cartoonist.
Narendra, you mentioned that you went all over India. I was just wondering, how did you travel in those days? Because nowadays, comedians can't really take flights.
Actually, we had a team.
It's okay, sir. Ladies and gentlemen, Narendra ji has been cartooning for longer than the three people on this panel have been alive. Can we give him a huge round of applause for his wonderful work? I'm going to move on to Sonu. Sonu, the next question is for you.
Yeah.
Now, you've worked across multiple mediums,
yeah,
radio, online, and live. You also do improv and stand-up.
Yeah.
What has been your experience across these mediums, and which medium have you found to be the most effective in bringing change through humor?
So whenever I perform, it's like, oh, there's a woman comic, oh, there's a girl on stage. So I don't know, I get that kind of sympathy, which I'm not very comfortable with now because I've been doing it for some time. But having said that, I think radio, live and online are very three different mediums. So radio, I am live, but what a reaction I'm getting from people about things that I talk about is not exactly live. I mean, they're listening to me, but I don't really know if, you know, it's making any sort of impact. And I feel live, their reaction is very filtered, as in, it's not the first thought that comes to your mind. And also, it's there are too many digressing comments online as well. But I think live is very real. I mean, if they are not liking it, I know it by their face. If they feel, oh, poor girl tried, that also I can make it from their face. So, you know, I don't know if I've had any bad days as such, because the sympathy is always there. So maybe internally I feel that, oh, I could have done better. But I think the unfortunately, at least because I do regional comedy and there is absolutely no representation in Kannada comedy by women. So there is no benchmark, unfortunately. So whatever I do is
so you're setting the benchmark.
And that's a lot of pressure, because I don't know if that's the way to go forward, because, you know, I mean, that's how I'm introduced most of the time. There's the first woman Kannada stand-up comic. So I don't know. I don't have any woman Kannada stand-up comic to go and talk to my woes about, you know, so.
In fact, it's interesting that you mentioned that, because my next question was exactly that, which is that, is the experience for you as a woman working in these industries very different? What are some of the unique challenges you faced, and how have you dealt with them? Are there any advantages you have being a woman? And how would you like to see things change for women going forward in our industry?
I'll start with advantages. So it's like, if she's not funny, she's cute. That's the advantage that I get. And I don't know if I'm happy with that.
Yeah, sadly, Varun and I will never get that either.
So, you know, so that's something. But, you know, it's so strange that whatever I perform and however I perform, people want to know who my husband is or who my, you know, like, and they're so curious about it. And my husband is not very, I have a husband. And then,
for the record, okay, back off, guys.
And he's not very social media friendly. So you will not find his pictures anywhere. So the first thing people come to me after the show is like, we want to know who your husband is. Why don't you put pictures with your husband? And, you know, where is he? And so it is always, it's most of the time, it's not about my work. It's about what are the things that I don't want to talk about. Or, you know, it's just how I choose it to be. But also, I feel that, you know, on the other hand, there are a lot of girls who are in college who come to me and say that we want to do this. And I feel very happy when they come and try out in the open mics. I mean, I'm in no position to mentor them because I myself am learning. But then it feels good to have girls coming out and, like, you know, speaking their mind. But there is always that filter. For example, I mean, this 2 days ago, I had a female comic who is aspiring to do more shows. She came and asked me, there's something about period I want to talk about, and you think I should talk about it. So there is always that filter that we put on ourselves before we say it. It might be too controversial, or people might just not like it, or, you know, so we kind of analyze it so much that I think that kills the beauty of making a joke, you know.
I want to interrupt you. What was your answer to that comic when she asked you that question?
I said, do not worry about the reaction. Just go ahead and say whatever you feel like. Because if you restrict yourself right now, maybe that thought will never make it on stage, or maybe people will never know. So I my advice is just go ahead and do. I mean, whoever comes and asks me, what do? I just say, go ahead and do it. Do not think how people are going to react. I mean, worst comes worst, they say that she's not good, but I think that's all right.
I think this would be the appropriate time for you to give her a round of applause. All right, let's come to Varun. Now, Varun, amongst many other things, you've been a writer, a lyricist, a poet, a stand-up comedian. What has been your approach towards using humor across the spectrum of what you do? Is there a certain point of view you have with regard to how you would like humor to be used? And does it change depending on the medium?
Oh, okay. Didn't I get the most complicated question of all? I don't know.
Sir, aap Varun Grover ho.
Okay.
National award willing.
National award isme kya bolte comprehension ability mein nahi mila tha. Isme gaana likhne ke liye mila tha. Par okay. So how much time do I get to answer this? Like main answer bana lu piche ja ke 15 minute. It's very okay. How do I use humor? That was
so just two questions.
Yeah.
First one is there a certain point of view you have with regard to how you want to use humor? And
yeah.
Secondly, does it change depending on which
medium
you're using it?
Yeah.
That's
okay.
It.
So yeah, like stand-up comedy is pure comedy for me, but my general take in life is to find the lightness in the situation, is to find what we call slice of life or relatability in the situation, things which are which we have seen, you know, which we have seen and still not seen this way. You know, that's what I try to bring through comedy also, things which are quite ordinary experiences we all have shared. And still, we have let those experiences slip into some, back lane of the mind. And, you know, it's just lying there drunk and passed out and all. And now I just kind of prick it and all. But that has been my whatever lens or perspective throughout life, because growing up when I was like 10 years old and when I was in school, I was an obese kid, and I was bullied a lot in school, and which is normal for, you know, obese kids in India or anywhere in the world probably. And I loved to play. I loved to play cricket, and nobody will, you know, take me in their team. I was mostly the umpire or, you know, the extra fielder on the boundary, and so I felt very, very suffocated with that space I was occupying, and I didn't know how to tackle the bullying. And then at some point I saw Raj Kapoor's film Mera Naam Joker, and in that the young Raj Kapoor is played by Rishi Kapoor, who is also an obese kid, and again he's bullied in the school and all. And then one day he discovers that if you make jokes on yourself, people will stop bullying you, and then that's how he becomes a joker in the film. And and quite different kind of joker than, you know, the recent joker we have. Gave me a lens.
Which recent joker are you talking about?
The Joaquin Phoenix film. Yeah. So, yeah. That joker was just, you know, that guy was bullied and all, and he joined a circus. This guy was bullied and he blew up the city. It was quite, you know, crazy. So, and that's what happens when you don't see the sense of humor in things, you know, probably. And so for me, that became a mission in life, to find humor in things and to start making jokes on myself and to start taking jokes in a lighter vein. And that actually helped. That was a trick which I just learned from a film, and that film actually flopped, but it changed my life, you know. And for me, that was, then I started seeing humor in everything, and it became my defense mechanism first of all, and then slowly it became my character, or the additional attraction in my character, and people started responding to it, and people started becoming friends. And then at some point I had, when I went to college, I had the biggest friend circle of all people I knew, just because of that, you know. And I was still obese when I went to college, and then slowly, because I went to Banaras Hindu University, it's a huge campus, and I cycled a lot. And by the fourth year, I became this really thin guy. And then I could have actually, you know, gone back to the humorless guy, but then I figured, okay, humor is working generally in life, not just because I want to protect myself. So yeah, that's how I got the perspective. That is the first part. And second, mediums. I don't know, medium, every medium has a different narrative form and it has to be, I try to keep it organic. You know, say in Sacred Games, wherever there is a space for humor, we have brought it, but then we can't compromise on the narrative, we can't compromise on, you know, on the world we are creating. So humor is not really, you know, the punchline, joke and punchline. It could be just very basic, because ultimately humor, as we know, is a fine sense of observation. And that's what we try to put in everything. So, yeah.
Another one for you. With SETC Democracy, which we will be privileged to watch tonight, I hope you're all going to stay for that. The group has been quite vocal against the current regime. What has been the response to that, both positive and negative?
Okay, so current regime is, so any regime actually, you know, and whatever, and their current is their fault, not ours. You know, we will talk about any regime which is there, and but there have been reactions of both kinds, yes, because we are living in a social media world where anybody can, you know, immediately praise you or immediately heckle you or immediately abuse you or send death threats or whatever. I would say mostly we have got really good response. There have been, of course, those kind of abuses and death threats and, you know, heckling at some places. But I think that's part of the game. Mostly the response has been very good, mainly because people, as I was saying in the beginning, humor is a very non-confrontational form. You know, it is ultimately, it is letting your guard down while you're laughing at something. So there are, there have been, the best kind of compliments have been from people who actually love the establishment. And they have, you know, they have sometimes met me at airports or wherever, or sometimes at the shows because they have been dragged there by their friends, or sometimes they come because, you know, because they are self-harm enthusiasts and they say, okay, we want to go and see what these guys are talking about and we'll feel angry. But they don't really feel that angry when they come to the show. And they've met me after the show and, you know, so many of them have told us that, you know, okay, we love our Prime Minister and still we love the jokes you do on the guy. And that's quite okay because, again, I think it goes back to our culture of shastrarthik culture hota tha. Argumentation hamara culture hai ek tarah se, jisme ki vaad vivaad hota hai, har cheez pe hota hai, har cheez ke sare point of view rakhe jate hain aur sabko rakhne ki ijazat hoti hai. Hamare constitution mein bhi hai aur hamare culture mein bhi hai. And I think people who understand this are quite okay with all kinds of jokes. We are just, you know.
So, hamare constitution mein hai, culture mein hai, sirf TV debate mein nahi hai.
TV debate is, I think, TV debate is a circus. We can't, you know, constitution mein circus shabd nahi hai. Aur, उसके बारे में कोई गाइडलाइंस भी नहीं है. इनफैक्ट जब कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन लिखा गया था तो उस समय टीवी चैनल भी नहीं थे. अदरवाइज दे प्रॉब्ली वुड हैव हैड सम काइंड ऑफ यू नो एक्ट अबाउट हाउ टू बिहेव इट्स इन दिस दैट प्रिजन एक्सपेरिमेंट एनवायरनमेंट दैट दिस दैट प्रिजन एक्सपेरिमेंट ना वही चल रहा है वहां पे. वो तो बेचारे क्या करें.
सो नरेंद्र जी एंड सोनू फॉर यू एज वेल, हैव यू एवर गॉट इनटू एनी काइंड ऑफ ट्रबल फॉर द यूज ऑफ ह्यूमर? फर्स्ट यू सर.
No, sir. I haven't faced any threat and any anything like that. Because I have been doing impartially. I have been doing. We have to draw our own Lakshman Rekha. We should not criticize beyond our capacity. And you don't have to hit below belt. And also that should be a moderate. And the message should go. Message should be read by the readers. That was our aim and objectives. That is how I have been doing this cartooning since beginning. I have not met any threats so far.
Sir, but can I ask a question? Because you said you we draw our Lakshman Rekhas. But the problem is, I think, in current times, everybody has their own Lakshman Rekha, and how does your Lakshman Rekha coincide with their Lakshman Rekha? In fact, everybody has their own Lakshman, and everybody has their own, you know, how do you manage that?
See, we should draw our own Lakshman Rekha first. Then we could study how others are drawing their Lakshman Rekha. See, in my opinion, we should always be impartial, not selective or not selecting any party-wise, and we should always be with the people. We should become the voice of the people, actually. We should criticize whoever comes to the throne, whoever comes to the ruling party. We should go on lampooning them. We should go on hitting them. That's all. We have been doing that.
Sonu?
Not yet, but the day they go beyond the fact the woman is telling jokes, I think I might get into trouble because I do some political jokes and things. I don't get laughs for those. But I think they are funny. So, you know, so there is a pin drop silence when I say something political. So I know which way the audience is aligning towards. But yeah, I mean, I think I still have some time for me to get a little scared. I will buy that time, yeah.
So I get banned from about 80% of the colleges that I perform in. Because when I go to the colleges, I always talk to the students and I ask them about what they think is unfair. And especially the engineering colleges really piss me off. So there is a college in Vellore, supposedly one of our premium institutes of engineering. If a boy shakes hands with a girl for longer than 3 seconds, it is considered a public display of affection. There is a fine for that. There are guards who are hired on campus to monitor this. There is an institute in Noida. If you're a foreign student, you can smoke on campus. If you're Indian, you cannot. How can that even be legal? It's like saying Indians and dogs not allowed. If you are wearing printed pajamas, when you go to sleep in your bed at night, there is a fine for that. So my problem is, and I go to these colleges, and because the faculty has so much power over the marks of the students, they're able to impose these ridiculous rules. Now, if the students' minds for 4 years are trained to not question stuff like this, how will they question established knowledge? So I go and question this, I do jokes about it, and then I get banned from this college. Sometimes they ban stand-up comedy, but then all the other colleges invite me for them. Okay, so we've got a few more questions, but I think let's open it up to the audience for audience Q&A. Just raise your hand, somebody will get a microphone to you, and then when they tell us we've got 5-7 minutes left, we'll bring it out to a close. Raise your hands, tell us your name, and please direct who you want to ask the question to.
Okay, this is Tanu. My question is to Varun. I really wonder if you are not afraid when you criticize the current government in power. I know you say that you will send them after Kunal Kamra first, and then that's your defense mechanism, but I want to know if you're really afraid or not.
Okay, no, I'm not afraid, because the day you are afraid, you lose. And the day I become afraid, I'll stop performing, because I'm generally a very paranoid person. Okay, I'm very paranoid even when I'm sitting in an auto, because I always think of a road accident. Even if I'm walking on the road, I'm not on a vehicle. I'm walking on the road. There's a traffic cop standing in the middle of the road, and he just looks at me. I feel I've done something wrong. Okay. I'm that paranoid about things. So I know the day I let this paranoia cover me, I'll just, you know, probably evaporate or dissolve or whatever is the chemical reaction after that. I won't be able to live or survive. So the only way for me is not to be afraid. And I, as I said, I trust our constitution. I trust the sensitivity and love of this country, and I trust the parampara, the culture of arguments and civilized debate in this country, and I hope it stays that way. Yeah.
But just don't trust the Uber drivers, because nowadays they might not take you to your destination, they might take you straight to the police station. Who's next? There's a gentleman there. Just stand up, tell us your name and ask the question.
My name is Shashank. My question is for all of them. How do you guys deal with the censorship? How do you, like films, Varun's films getting banned, Varun's show was, few people protested against his show. There was one show which AIB did, and their effigies were burnt. You were banned from colleges, and she is always seen as a girl, and his cartoons were banned in emergency. How does, if you are a voice to the people, and when the voice is cut out, how do you deal with it?
Sir.
Yeah, that is a good question. When Indira Gandhi clamped emergency in 1975, I remember a very good cartoon in Indian Express that is drawn by Abu Abraham. The next day morning, we saw the picture is Fakhruddin Ali Ahmad, the president, is bathing in a bathtub, and Indira Gandhi's emissary is pushing an ordinance to sign it. Now he says this. That is the way of the next day. Indira banned all the cartoons in all the newspapers. Till she revoked the emergency, no cartoon was published in the newspapers. That was the day. We still remember that Abu Abraham's cartoon.
So how did that make you feel? How did that make you feel? How did you feel like responding to that? If that's your question.
That is awesome. That is against the Constitution, but we have to bear with that. There is no other way. Even if we draw cartoons, newspaper people won't publish it at all. So it won't come to them. People will not be knowing what we have drawn.
You know, it's quite interesting. There's this story about a khargosh hota hai. There's a rabbit who's challenging a lion to a fight. And he's saying, oh, you coward, this, that. And he's really threatening him. And the lion is refusing to fight with him. So another animal asks the lion, he says, why don't you fight? He said, listen, he's a rabbit. Now, if I kill him, everyone is going to say, look, tiny little rabbit, that lion defeated him. Now, by chance, if that rabbit beats me, I will have no face to show. So when a lion is actually taking you on, are they actually giving you that level of credibility? That boss, tu to sher hai, main tumse itna darta hu, that I need to be able to respond to this. I don't know, Varun, what are your thoughts on that?
I think that's right, and that's why most of the, governments or establishment keep kind of delaying these things and let the angry foot soldiers do something about it if they want to, or kind of facilitate them in some ways, because direct attack is brings both of them to the same stature, and ultimately it kind of doesn't work for the public in general. But apart from that, I think being an artist is about being one, anticipating censorship, anticipating what could go wrong, and then finding, as Sir said, finding your Lakshman Rekha and being clever about it. Ultimately, we have the craft. Okay, they don't have the craft. We have the craft, and it's our responsibility if a joke goes wrong or is misinterpreted. I think the onus is on us to make it better next time, and find a better way to say it if you still want to say the same thing. So, yeah.
I work for radio, so there is censorship there anyway. You know, there are so many topics that I cannot touch upon. Like whatever political things happen, I cannot voice my opinion. I mean, I can't even state the facts. I mean, it's that. So sometimes it makes me feel weak in those 4 hours, because there is something happening in the world, and I'm talking about some movie releasing which is not very important at that point in time, which is why at least for me what works is having different platforms where at least when I go online or when I perform live, I don't censor myself because I don't think there's a point in doing that. Because you are signed by this media house and it's part of your contract that you're not going to say XYZ things, you just have to adhere to that. But otherwise, I think online and live, there is no need of... I mean, repercussions will... I mean, we'll see when we come there, but I don't think there is any need of self-censorship when it comes to that, yeah.
So I think there are, I'll tell you from my perspective, I think there are multiple different things as artists we have to think about when we are drawing this line. One of it is your own value system. There are certain things you will say, there are certain things you will not say. If there is an 80-year-old in the front, I will not pick on him because that is my value system. The second thing is the environment. If you have come for my live show in a public show, I will do what I want. If you don't like it, you're welcome to leave. If I'm doing a corporate show, if I'm doing a private show, I've come to a private party, it is my duty as a professional to respect the boundaries of where I am. The second thing you have to think about is, we can always argue about how things should be, but there is a reality of how things are. So for example, when Charlie Hebdo happened, right? You can go on till kingdom come arguing of whether it should happen, should not have happened. You can't say you were surprised. So when the artist is on stage, he has to take a personal decision as to whether getting his or her point of view across is more important or his or her safety is more important because something may or may not happen. The other thing that happens is that sometimes we have to think about more about what, not so much about what we say, but where we say it. So in a live show, for example, my audience understands my persona, they understand the context, they understand the intent, and I can do certain jokes. Now, if somebody was to record that and stick exactly the same video clip on the internet, people who are not in that room, who have not come to enjoy a certain kind of humor, can take it out of context. If you look at most of the controversies with stand-up in India, it never happens at the live gig. It happens the second it goes online. Then the other thing is, I always say we are the largest democracy on the planet. We are also the largest hypocrisy on the planet. One of the big accusations we get is that English language stand-up comedy is vulgar, right? Now, let me ask the audience, why does a comedian crack a joke? Why? Because he wants you to laugh. If you stop laughing at those jokes, we will stop cracking them. So my argument is that you are vulgar, right? So as an audience, it is your job. See, the other thing is we are a large country. In a smaller country, as an audience evolves, the performers are forced to evolve as well because you demand better of them. But in our country, the second an audience evolves, somebody else comes and takes their place. So in many cases, that pressure is not there on the performer to get better. So I think there is a responsibility on you as the audience as well to evolve and demand better of whether it is your performers, of your government, of whoever else is around you, instead of pointing the finger at us poor struggling artists. Right, what should we close with? Should we have, time for one last question. Let's go to the lady there in the third row. We have time. He's given us this 5-minute board over there. So the lady in the third row, can we get a microphone to her? And then we'll go for closing comments.
Sorry. Hi, this is Akanksha. And I don't really have a question, but sitting through this discussion and pondering over what we're talking about, I just want to say that you guys are doing a great job. And why I'm saying that is because there's a huge, there's a larger shelf life for a comic scene or a joke. So when I look back at things in the larger scheme of Game of Thrones, I still remember the chai and the parle ji. In the larger scheme of what happened around Padmavati, I absolutely remember the comic stand-up that you did. And I think that should give you a lot of strength in what you guys are doing. We remember it right at the times we are supposed to remember it. And it's too simple for most of us to get it. And the subliminal message is always there. So just good luck with what you're doing.
Thank you. Any questions that the panelists would like to ask the audience or any of the other panelists, sir? Anything you would like to ask, if there is anything at all, before we wrap up?
I actually wanted to ask a question to Varun, you know, because this is what we do, and this is also the bread and butter or whatever. So where do you draw the line between the commercial part of it and the artistic part of it?
I don't think there's a line. Ultimately, my only whatever mantra is to myself to not do anything which I don't like. So, and luckily, I've not been forced to do that till now. There are enough opportunities, there are enough shows, there is enough whatever audience support till now that I can do whatever I want to do. And still, I would say commercial is part of it in a way that, yeah, we survive on it. But for me, primarily, it is about the artistic fulfillment and just solving myself. That's what it is. So, yeah.
Superb. One last question, the elderly gentleman.
We do have time for two questions.
We have time for two questions?
Yes.
Okay, then.
So, one is from here.
From where? Where? Just stand up wherever you are because your voice. Go on, sir.
So, Varun, since I share a different relationship, Charbagh and Assighat, with you, so I'm taking a liberty to ask you this question.
Just keep the mic closer, yeah.
You said kagaj nahi dikhayenge, right? Now you are displaying your kagaj. So, koi humorous agar aap bata saken kyun?
वैसे मैं ये शाम को बताने वाला था क्योंकि ये जो है ना लोगों ने सुन लिया कागज नहीं दिखाएंगे उसके बाद मेरे से पूछ रहे हैं तुम फ्लाइट में क्यों आ रहे हो कागज नहीं दिखाएंगे जो मैंने जब बोला उसके नीचे भी वो ट्रांसलेशन में लिखा हुआ है एनआरसी पेपर्स वी वांट शो राइट उसमें क्लियरली लिखा है दिस इज अबाउट डिस्क्रिमिनेटरी प्रैक्टिस एंड दैट्स व्हाई व्हेन द डिस्क्रिमिनेशन इज इंप्लीमेंटेड वी विल डू सिविल डिसोबीडियंस एज यू नो एज आई whatever ideated by Mahatma Gandhi. तो हाँ उसका वो जवाब ये जो बहुत लोग बोलते हैं अच्छा आप यहाँ कागज़ अच्छा आप राशन लेने के लिए कागज़ क्यों दिखा रहे हो अच्छा आप यहाँ कागज़ फोटो कॉपी की दुकान पर क्यों जा रहे हो है ना ऐसे पूछने लगते हैं बहुत सारे लोग तो because it's a poetic suggestion, it's a poetic civil disobedience. उसके पीछे metaphor होते हैं उसके पीछे एक बहुत लंबी कहानी होती है महात्मा गांधी ने जब नमक सत्याग्रह किया था उनको आयोडीन की कमी तो नहीं थी अब खड़े होकर अंग्रेज बोले कि आपको आयोडीन की कमी है क्या क्यों कर रहे हो भाई नमक सत्याग्रह है ना या जो उनके साथ जितने लोग चले गए थे वो क्या उनके घर में नमक नहीं था था ना वो दैट वॉज जस्ट अ सिम्बॉलिक जेस्चर एंड दैट्स वॉट इट इज दैट्स वॉट दिस लाइन इज अल्टीमेटली एंड आई नो पीपल हु अंडरस्टैंडिंग एंड पीपल हु आर नॉट अंडरस्टैंडिंग आर डेलिबरेटली मिसअंडरस्टैंडिंग एंड दैट इज समथिंग वी हैव टू दैट्स वाई सत्याग्रह कितना सुंदर शब्द है सत्य का आग्रह करते रहो बोलते रहो बोलते रहो एक पॉइंट पे क्योंकि सत्य जो है वो बहुत स्टेबल होता है और वो उसको आपको बार बार सोचने की जरूरत नहीं होती जो सामने वाला है जो उसको हटाने के रीजन हर रोज सोचता रहता है कि अच्छा इस वजह से मैं नहीं सुनूंगा तेरी बात या इस वजह से नहीं सुनूंगा वो रीजन एक पॉइंट पे खत्म हो जाते हैं एंड सत्य स्टेज एंड दैट्स व्हाट वी विल कीप डूइंग थैंक यू
लास्ट क्वेश्चन द जेंटलमैन हियर
माय नेम इज कृष्णस्वामी अल्लाड़ी यू आर टॉकिंग अबाउट इंडियन कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन एंड ह्यूमर
Sir, just keep the microphone closer to your mouth, this way.
Varun, you were talking about Indian constitution in humor. My grandfather's brother is one of the three who wrote the Indian constitution. His name is Sir Krishnaswamy Alladi Iyer. I was talking to his son and I asked him the same question, how come there's no humor in Indian constitution and, you know, And he said, the Indian constitution itself is a joke. That is what he said.
So there was no question there then. All right. I think on that note, before we end, are there any more sessions you're doing today, sir?
No.
Are you doing any more sessions today? Esi Tesi Democracy is performing at 7 o'clock today. Please do come and catch them outside. I have a session here at 6 o'clock today. Before we finish, a round of applause for all our panelists. Narendraji, thank you so much. Varun Grover and Sonu Venugopal.
My name is Papa CJ.
Guys, God bless you. Cheers.